please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Let's get to the big headline this evening. Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi has filed his nomination to become the next president of the party, as was anticipated. Rahul Gandhi was accompanied by Manmohan Singh, Kamal Nath, Jyotiraditya Scindia and senior Congress leaders. Rahul Gandhi made his foray into active politics, remember, in 2004 when he contested the Lok Sabha elections from Amethi. He was appointed the Congress General Secretary in 2007. The next year, he also assumed charge as AICC General Secretary. In 2013, Rahul Gandhi was appointed as the Congress Vice President. Today, Congress leaders extended their wishes to Rahul, saying that his elevation to the post of Congress President will strengthen the party like never before. Listen in.
Rahul ji has been the darling of the congressmen and congresswomen, and this is yet another step in his quest for serving the people through the Congress Party as a chosen vehicle.
Rahul ji, ye zimmedari sambhal rahe hain ek aise samay mein jab desh ke samne aur Congress ke samne badi chunautiyan hain. पूरी कांग्रेस एकजुट होकर उनके साथ खड़ी है उनको समर्थन देने में और उनकी कामयाबी के लिए
आई थिंक वेरी वेरी मच दिस इज अ यंग इंडिया एंड यू हैव अ यंग प्रेसिडेंट कमिंग तो मेरा ख्याल बहुत एक पॉजिटिव बात है
2019 से प्राइम मिनिस्ट्रियल कैंडिडेट के रूप में आपको लगता
वो अगली बात है बट इफ यू आस्क मी आई थिंक ही विल मेक अ वेरी गुड प्राइम मिनिस्टर आज एक नई शुरुआत एक नई सुबह कांग्रेस के लिए नहीं लेकिन पूरे देश के लिए होने वाली है मैं मानता हूं ये एक शुभ अवसर और संकेत पूरे देश के लिए होगा चाहे वो युवा पीढ़ी में हो चाहे वो किसी और भी उम्र के वर्ग में हो उन सब का इस्तेमाल राहुल जी करेंगे इसका हमें पूरा पूरा विश्वास है
Whole host of Congress leaders on their expectation of Rahul Gandhi as he seems set to be elected unopposed for the party's top job. Let's bring in Pallavi Ghosh who's joining in with more on Rahul Gandhi's elevation. Pallavi, what's the inside story?
Yes, I mean, it's almost certain now that Rahul is going to become the next party president. In fact, the nominations have ended. They ended at 3 o'clock. Sonia and Dr. Manmohan Singh, among other senior Congress leaders, were the ones who proposed his name. After that, this is just mere technicality. They're just going to wait, I think, till the 11th, which is the last day for the withdrawal of nominations. And in case Rahul Gandhi is the only one to file his nominations, and what we're being told by the party, he certainly is, then the decks are cleared for him. The reins of the party passes on to Rahul's hands and Sonia gives up charge after 19 long years. But it's certainly not going to be an easy ride for Rahul. The first big test he's going to face is in Gujarat and Himachal Pradesh. But more than that, the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, which is going to be a straight confrontation between him and the Prime Minister. It's very important for Rahul Gandhi. And the biggest challenge also for Rahul would be, of course, to revive the Congress Party.
Okay, Pallavi, thanks for that. We'll keep revisiting this story. But while Rahul Gandhi filed his nomination papers for the post of the Congress President, Prime Minister Narendra Modi launched a scathing attack at the Grand Old Party. Addressing a rally in Gujarat, the Prime Minister referred to an interview excerpt of Congress leader Mani Shankar Iyer, played by a TV news channel, and criticised the Congress once again for dynasty politics.
Ye Sriman Mani Shankar Iyer aaje kahyu che कि जहांगीर की जगह जब शाहजहां आए क्या तब इलेक्शन हुआ था जब शाहजहां की जगह पे औरंगजेब आए तब क्या कोई इलेक्शन हुआ था यह तो पहले से ही पता था कि जो बादशाह है उसकी औलाद को ही सत्ता मिलेगी इसका मतलब यह हुआ कि कांग्रेस के वरिष्ठ नेता ये खुद मानते हैं कि कांग्रेस पार्टी ये पार्टी नहीं है एक कुनबा है और उनका किसी का सत्ता पर आने का मतलब है कि बादशाह की औलाद का बैठना, ये औरंगजेब राज, उनको मुबारक।
Okay, however, Congress leader Mani Shankar Iyer later clarified on his statement that he had given out back then. Here are what he had to say.
जहांगीर के बेटे ही शाहजहां बन सकते थे। अब जमाना बदल गया है। कोई भी कांग्रेसिया अपना नामांकन कर सकता है और तय किया जा सकता है। हमने देखा पिछले बार कि जितेंद्र प्रसाद जी ने खड़े हुए और सोनिया जी के खिलाफ वो खड़े हुए, तो आज भी किसी को भी इजाजत है कि वो खड़े हों। तो ये एक आम चुनाव है, जैसा कि चुनाव समझा जाता है एक लोकतंत्र में।
Okay, let's move on to the big corporate story of the day. After a turbulent year involving a nasty spat between its board and founders, IT giant Infosys has a new man at the helm. Salil Parekh has been appointed Managing Director and CEO of Infosys for a period of 5 years. His appointment will be effective from 2nd of January 2018. There are several areas that Salil will be bringing to the table, but I spoke to Kiran Mazumdar Shah, the Independent Director at Infosys, earlier today and began by asking her about the rationale behind the board's decision to pick Salil Parekh as the CEO. Here's that conversation.
We had a very rich canvas of almost 30 candidates provided to us by Egon Zander. And by applying a set of metrics which we thought were extremely important for the search, we whittled down the list to about 10. And Salil, of course, was one of them. And I think what really we were concerned about as an NRC was the fact that we were looking for someone who had a good experience in the sector, someone who had a good global understanding of the business, someone who understood new trends in this whole sector, and someone who had also had played some important roles in the sector. And in this case, of course, Salil also had a good experience with M&A and of course managing a large workforce in India. So I think culturally, I think he was one of those who had a very good understanding of working in India, and had a very long and rich experience in the sector, because he understood what the whole services sector was about. So overall, I think he had a very holistic set of attributes which swung it in his favor.
Okay, Mr. Shah, just to understand here, what happens now with Praveen Rao still being the COO? Was Praveen one of the contenders? And, you know, I understand that there could be some kind of dynamics changes that will be required now with Praveen stepping, who was the interim CEO, now going back to the COO position.
I think Praveen Rao is a very mature leader, and I think he understood what was required of his role as an interim CEO. He himself has basically, offered to resume his role as a COO. I don't think there are any dynamics that you're talking about. So,
but was Praveen one of the contenders that were being
looked
at?
He was not. In fact, he didn't even want to be considered. So I think your interpretation is wrong.
Okay. I wanted to understand as well, Mr. Shah, would there be further changes that we can expect on the board, on the management, with the new CEO now coming on? And I would assume that Salil would be appointed to the board as well once he's joined.
Yes, he will be inducted into the board. And I don't want to comment on any of the other questions, because these are pure speculative in nature. And I think we should just wait for Salil to take charge and move on with focusing on his new role.
Okay, one last question as far as what the immediate challenge would be. How do you think Salil is going to take up the challenge of the changing dynamics in the IT industry, and of course the increasing the cohesiveness in the conversation between the board, the founders, as well as the management?
Look, he's been selected because we believe he has all these abilities, and I think we should just wait for the 2nd of January when he takes charge, and I'm sure you will see him, addressing his new role in a very mature way.
Okay, let's talk about what Salil Parekh really brings to the table. Remember, Salil Parekh had joined Capgemini in 2000 once he took over after EY's IT services business was acquired from Capgemini. His appointment right now is effective for 5 years, but that is, of course, conditional to further extension as well. He was heading the IT the entire Indian division of Capgemini, and he played a critical role in expanding the headcount from the 25,000 employees that were there in 2000 to 100,000 employees that stand today. He also ended up going on and rising up the ranks to become the head of the APAC business. He ended his term as a deputy CEO along with two others who were elevated, as well as a member of the critical board. So let's talk about what he really brings to the table once he does join Infosys. Salil has a very strong expertise as far as the North America and Europe business is concerned. He has a very strong expertise in consulting. And if you look at Capgemini and Infy's overall framework, they both have a strong focus on consulting. They have a similar working structure, similar vertical layout, which Salil will bring to the table. He brings IT services expertise, as you heard Kiraz Mazumdar Shaw talk about. Not just that, Salil was responsible for the acquisition of iGate in 2015. And that is what investors will be hoping that Salil would be able to incorporate in Infosys as well, the ability to take big bang acquisition bets. Over and above that, Salil ended his term heading the SMAC business, which is the emerging technology business, which is the big growth area. And that's where the challenges lie. So let's pull up those points for you as well. The immediate challenge will be to increase the conversation between promoters, management, and create a cohesive dialogue, and not just bridging the gaps between the founders, promoters, the management, as well as the board. He will have to increase the kind of investment that is required into digital technologies and acquisition, perhaps go aggressive there, strengthen the sales function, rebuild brand emphasis for the clients, as well as for bettering the employee morale, and ensure that what happened in the last 1 year is something that the Infosys brand can shrug off with ease. So that's what we are able to pick up on what challenges will lie. We'll have to wait and watch until 2nd of January to see what salary brings to the table. Let's take a look at how the markets fared today then. The Wall Street did not manage to shrug off the Monday blues today, with the markets did manage to end in the green with marginal gains. The bank stocks underperformed, and that index closed about 0.5% in the red. The mid-caps more or less mirrored the benchmark indices. Let's bring in Anuj Singhal to take us through the day's trading action. Anuj, safe to say that there was no particular trend today, but it seemed like a broad-based day where, yes, bulls were up and about once in a while.
Well, it was a bit of a sideways day for the market after two trend days, but the larger trend was that rallies were being sold into. There was, of course, a big gap up which was sold into. And post-noon, there was another sort of rally that was sold into. However, the Nifty managed to sort of survive the 10,100 crucial support mark, courtesy Infosys, though the Bank Nifty, of course, was a bit weak. Infosys was that stock that actually batted for the bulls today, along with Lever and HDFC. Tata Motors, India Bulls Housing and Hindalco were the other big gainers.
Okay, Anuj, we'll leave it at that. Let's just cut across to CNN News 18. Some important updates coming in from Sanjay Suri on the Vijay Mallya case in London.
There is a case law developing, and there are precedents developing where the court does override those considerations and order extradition on the condition that specific assurances are given about the rights and the conditions of someone detained, and conditions that are independently verifiable. It will be critical if India can offer such assurances.
And as Sanjay has been pointing out, let's quickly tell our viewers once again this nugget of information, which is quite crucial as the hearing starts today. After 10 days of hearing from the 4th to the 14th, there's a Christmas break, and after which in late January or early February, rather, we are likely to see a verdict in the Vijay Mallya case. At least that's what the scenario seems to suggest at the moment, that we could see a verdict by early next year. Sanjay, I want to come back to you on the question of the defense that Vijay Mallya has been looking at, or rather his team has been looking at. Will the Sanjeev Chawla case, as you are pointing out, have a bearing on this case as well?
Well, in courts, all previous cases have a bearing to the extent that they become precedents and become a guide, not necessarily a binding guide, but certainly a guide for the magistrate to consider. And this is not just Sanjeev Chawla. We've seen this earlier with the case of Nadeem. We've seen this with earlier cases with Mirchi. These human rights conditions being raised in India, and courts taking cognizance of it. So the most recent of these, being that of Sanjeev Chawla, turned out to be the decisive one. The judge made very precise observations. She said that she is satisfied that there is substantive strength in the allegations against him, that she is satisfied that he would receive fair trial in India. And yet, she was not satisfied about the conditions in Tihar jail. And that became a reason for her to block the extradition. So that happened just a few weeks back, right in court here. So it is almost inevitable that to add to other lines of defense, Malia's defense will bring this up as well.
Hmm. Sanjay, also the proceedings have already been delayed by 1 hour, 20 minutes, I believe. Take us through what exactly happened. The fire alarm went off, we understand. And did the proceedings not start at all? Were they interrupted in between? What happened?
No, the proceedings were not interrupted because they never got off to a start at all. People were just filing into the court and Malia had just about gone in when we had this fire alarm and people were asked to vacate the building immediately. And that is the going back an hour or so. And all this while we've been outside hanging out with Malia, with not much by way of a conversation with him, but certainly sharing the space outside with him.
Hmm. And he's certainly not willing to take any questions today. Sanjay, what kind of questions were thrown at him? Did any of them unsettle him?
Apparently not. I think they annoyed him but didn't unsettle him, in the sense that he remains unfazed. He said within a few minutes of his arrival that he is confident that the charges against him are fabricated. He would seem to suggest that they would be proven to be fabricated. So he did make some strong assertions when he came in. Since then, he's been asked about the charges against him again and again. He's been asked about whether the human rights angle will be a defense. He's currently choosing to say very little is doing very little other than hanging around here and smoking his cigar.
And Sanjay, perhaps that's also a diktat from his defense team, that he should not be speaking much to the media, because from what I remember is that earlier on he would have extensive conversations with the reporters standing outside.
Yes, and in fact he did this morning for a short while. Following that, he's clammed up. So I think the fact is that this waiting game outside that nobody anticipated has gone on for a bit. He has gone on facing questions, made his denials, and he's currently choosing to stay absolutely silent. Not something that is characteristic of him in normal times, but he seems to have had enough of these questions for now.
Absolutely. He's blowing a cigar. He's, in fact, now working on his mobile phone, browsing through perhaps some of the latest information that he can gather. We don't know what exactly, but Vijay Malia certainly standing out there right outside the Westminster Magistrates Court in London. Sanjay Suri there reporting, getting us the very latest from London. It's been an hour and 20 minutes approximately since the court proceedings have been delayed as a fire alarm went off. We are taking a very quick break, but
we'll get Sanjay back to the channel as well, but here's what Vijay Malia had to say to reporters in London just a short while ago.
You are 30 minutes away from a formal court hearing. Listen to the submissions yourself and report accurately. I have nothing to say.
Just a reminder, our viewers, there was a hearing in London, and the reason why Sanjay Suri, along with a whole host of reporters, are outside hanging out with Malia, not really having any conversation per se, is because there was a fire alarm that went off and they're waiting for those proceedings to begin again. Big, big exclusive from the aviation sector, English business magnate, founder of the Virgin Group, as well as one of the biggest billionaires of the world, Richard Branson, says his airline Virgin Atlantic will benefit indirectly from the recent Jet Airways and Air France KLM deal. Speaking to CNBC TV18's Utkarsh Chaturvedi in the Bahamas, Branson added that he missed the bus as far as investing in India goes, and the gates for investment seem closed now. Here's that chat.
Speaking about your recent tie-up with Delta and KLM, and Jet Airways 3 days back did the same kind of a tie-up with Delta and KLM. So will there be any of the benefit you will be getting with the tie-up which Delta, KLM and Jet Airways has taken in India?
Indirectly, if Delta and KLM are doing well, we will do well. And you know, we've also tied up with KLM and Air France as well. So I think that it should be, it looks like it could be part of a bigger alliance.
So can we hope for a bigger alliance in the Indian market? But you said the gates are closed in the Indian market, but do you see any small opportunity for an Indian market entry? And if there is a possibility, will you enter?
Maybe I should rethink it. I haven't thought about it for a while because I've had space and I've had Virgin Hyperloop and a number of other things on my mind. And a tennis tournament I'm just doing here.
Yeah.
But you never know.
The last question, sir. You know, the Air India national carrier right now, the government is speaking about this investment of the national carrier Air India. How much value do you think that can have for the global investors?
I haven't looked at the figures of Air India, but government shouldn't be running airlines. They don't make a good job running airlines. The government shouldn't really be running companies, I think. I respect them for looking for people who can run it and run it more successfully.
Okay, that's the big exclusive interview. But for now, we'll have to wrap up this edition of After the Bell Money. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned, though. Markets Today Talkback will take all the action forward on the other side. Don't go anywhere.